Really, Emor really is the parasha of Kedusha, because there are three different levels of Kedusha that this parasha deals with. As we mentioned in the past as well, I'll go from lower to higher. The Kedushas Hamakom, sanctity of place, the Beis HaMikdash, the Beis HaKnesses, that's Kedusha, Kedusha of the place. Then the parasha talks about all the Moadim, all the holidays. That's Kedushas Hazman, that's sanctity of time. And if there's a conflict between Kedushas Hamakom and Kedushas Hazman, which one takes precedence? So we know Kedushas Man takes precedence. As we know, when the Jewish people were involved in Binyan HaMikdash, building the Mishkan, so they stopped building the Mishkan on Shabbos. The building of the Mishkan did not supersede the Shabbos. So we see from here that Kedushas Hazman, the sanctity of Shabbos, overrides the sanctity of building the Mishkan. And the highest level is Kedushas HaAdam. That's the Kohanim have the, besides having the regular Kedushas Yisrael, they have the level of Kedushas Kahuna. And we see every Jew, every person is more chashev than the Mishkan. It's more important than the Mishkan, because we know the halacha is, if you're building the Mishkan and Shabbos comes, stop building, you'll regroup on Sunday, Yom Rishon. But if someone's life is on the line and you have to desecrate the Shabbos to save the person's life, you go ahead and do it. You have an obligation, pikuach nefesh. And it says, as the Yerushalmi says, the Jerusalem Talmud says, that the first halacha a rabbi should teach his community is the laws of pikuach nefesh, that you shouldn't, and that you, they shouldn't have to ask the question. They should already know what to do, because every second counts. And in fact, the Jerusalem Talmud has a lashon, the one who asks the question is ki'ilu shofech damim. He's like spilling blood, because the time he's wasting asking the question, that could be the difference between life and death. And it also says the one who's asked the question is not a good thing. Why is it my fault if they come to me and ask me the question? Not me, of course, personally, but the Rav of the town, whoever it might be, that means they didn't teach that halacha. You shouldn't have to come to the Rav. You should already have taught that. The first sermon he gives should be on Pikuach Nefesh. That when someone's life is in danger, don't come to me, call the doctor, go to the hospital. And in fact, even a, oh, but let's say you're not sure. You don't know it's pikuach nefesh. Suffolk, even a doubtful pikuach nefesh, that also supersedes the Shabbat. So that's what we learn out. So we learn out from this parsha all the different levels of Kedusha. And Kedusha's HaMakom is the lowest of all levels, but it's still very important. You have the Kedushas Hazman of the Shabbos and the Moadim. And you have the highest level, Kedushas HaAdam, all of us human beings born with Selevan Elokim. And of course, Kohanim even have a higher level of Kedusha. And therefore, they have the certain privileges and responsibilities. And in fact, they point out that there are different levels of Kedusha. We know there's Kedusha Shabbos and Kedusha Yontif. There's the sanctity of the Shabbos, we know, and the sanctity of Yontif. What is the difference? Is the Kedusha on Shabbos similar, or is it the same? Is it identical to Yontif, or are the two different types? So our rabbis tell us there's a fundamental difference between the Kedusha on Shabbos and the Kedusha on Yontif. Kedusha on Shabbos has inherent Kedusha. God created the world in 6 days and rested on the seventh day. Shabbos is kiva v'kami. It's set up. There's nothing we have to do. We just got to show up. Of course, we have an additional mitzvah of Tosefes Shabbos. We want to bring it in earlier. But bottom line is, we do nothing, Shabbos is here. Masha Ein Kein, Yontif, even though today it might show up without us anyway, but from a theological point of view, from a halachic point of view, Yontif is Makadesh Yisrael V'Hazmanim. Bizman, when we had the Beis Din sanctifying the month, someone had to go to Beis Din, testify the moon was out, and it was the Jewish people who brought the Kedusha. So it's a fundamental difference between Shabbos and Yontif. Shabbos, the Kedusha is inherent. By Yontif, it's we bring it. And in fact, that's how some explain. We know we have a minhag of Friday Night Live, Kabbalah Shabbos, known as the Kalbach minyan, but that's throughout North America. But whether you do Kalbach or not, Friday night you have Kabbalah Shabbos. So why don't we have Kabbalah Yontif? Why don't we have a similar prayer in between Mincha and Yontif? Why do we only have Kabbalah Shabbos and not Kabbalah Yontif? So, you know, the different answers in terms of that one is the differences between Shabbos and Yontif, that when one time we go to God, he comes to us, but they point out that the difference is it's redundant. On Shabbos, as we said, Shabbos comes by itself. So we want to bring it in, we do a Kabbalah, that's why we do a Tosefes Shabbos. By Yontif, Yontif's only here because Makadesh Yisrael V'Hazmanim. We brought the Kedusha. So there's nothing, we don't need a Kabbalah Yontif, we already brought the Kedusha. And therefore, we don't need a Kabbalah Yontif. And that's why we just observed Yom Ha'atzma'ut, Israel Independence Day this week. Or be today was it this year was a discussion exactly what day it was on, Monday or Tuesday, but that's not for now. But I'm not even talking about Yom Ha'atzma'ut, I'm talking about Kedushas Eretz Yisrael. I'm talking about the sanctity of the land of Israel. So what is Kedusha Eretz Yisrael comparable to? Is it comparable to Kedusha Shabbos, to the sanctity of Shabbos, or is it compared to the sanctity of Yontif? I said Shabbos is inherent Kedusha. Yontif, we bring the Kedusha. So the commentators explain by Eretz Yisrael, there's a two-tiered Kedusha. It has both levels. On one hand, we know God at the Bris Bet Absarim gave it over to Avram Avinu, and Avram walked around. That was the inherent, there's inherent land, inherent Kedusha of the land of Israel. It's different than all other lands, inherently by itself. However, we also know and there's certain halachas, you have special mitzvahs hatluyus ba'aretz, special mitzvahs that only apply in Israel, like taking off tithes, truma, maisa, shmita, not working the land. When did that start applying? When Yeshua conquered the land, right away, did these laws apply? The answer is no. The first 7 years was Sheva Shekivshu, the 7 years were years of conquest, of war. And the next 7 years were years of giving out the Yerusha, the inheritance. So the laws of Truma Samaita did not begin until year 15. So we see why did it begin right away? Because first, there's an inherent level of Kedushas Eretz Yisrael. However, there's a second level depending on us. When we're Makadish to land, we raise the level. That's what the Gemara tells us. In Yuma, based on Psukim, that when Klai Yisrael come back, that's why there's halachas of Bi'at Kulchem. There's certain halachas that only apply in Israel when you have the majority of Jews living there. So Eretz Israel has a two-tiered Kedusha. On one hand, it's the land of Avram, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, the Avos. But on the other hand, we endow with Kedusha by the Jewish people living in it and Yeshua conquering the land, so you have both levels of Kedusha. In fact, it's interesting, Shemi Shmuel, who points out as follows. As halacha, we just finished Pesach a couple weeks ago, And we know, and every Shabbos as well, we make Havdalah. We know we make Kiddush Friday night, and we make Havdalah Saturday. It's like the bookends. So Yontif, we also make Havdalah. So, you know, Yontif, let's say we have the first 2 days. In fact, there's a discussion in the Gemara in Beya about making Havdalah between Yontif Rishon and Yontif Sheni. In Eretz Yisrael, but they only keep 1 day, so you make Havdalah after the first day. But in Chutz Aretz, we keep 2 days. So there's a discussion in the Gemara whether we should make Havdalah or not in between Yontif Rishon and Yontif Sheni to show, because it's a different level of Kedusha. The meaning is we don't, for different reasons. Not to cause a zilzul to Yontif Sheni, but really, strictly speaking, we should. But either way, we make Havdalah in Chutz Aretz Yontif Sheni. After the second day Yontif, we make Havdalah. What do we make? Do we make the same Havdalah on Yontif as we do when Shabbos is over?
No.
What do we leave out? Or what do we add? So Shabbos, we know we have Bo'e Priya Gafen and Hamavdil Ben Kodesh Ucho. Shabbos, we also have what? The Besamim, smelling the spices. And we also have Bo'e Ma'ore Ha'esh. We make the blessing. On Yontif, all we have is Bo'e Priya Gafen and Hamavdil Ben Kodesh Ucho. We don't make a bracha on the Esh, because number one, on Yontif, we use fire anyway. But And we also don't make a borei b'nei b'samim. How come? Why do we discriminate against Yontif? Why does it get the short end of the stick? No b'samim. Everyone loves b'samim. So how come Yontif, Motzai Yontif, we don't have b'samim? So to understand that, we have to understand why do we have b'samim Saturday night? So, good question. And the answer is because there's something called the Nishma Yisera, an extra soul. I know this, and I know some doctors said they've done autopsies and they haven't found it, but it's not a physical concept, it's a spiritual one. We have a Nishma Yisera. In fact, we all know it because Rashi says, you know, as you eat a lot more on Shabbos, you got hungrier, you have someone else to fill up as well. Because the food we eat on Shabbos is spiritual, so the neshama needs it also. So we eat more on Shabbos because we have an extra. So we have a neshama yisera on Yontif, but it leaves, on Shabbos, but it leaves when Shabbos is over. So it's a big down off. We're very sad, depressed, not clinically depressed, but we're just down. Within the norms of down, and we need something to cheer us up. So we'd have a nice smell of the besamim to try to buffer our loss of the neshama yisera. So that's why we have besamim motzoi Shabbos. So let me ask you something. Do we have a neshama yisera on Yontif? If it's based on food, then I'd say yes. We eat a lot on Yontif as well. But that's actually a machlokes harishonim, whether Rashbam and Tosfos, on whether you have a neshama yisera on Yontif. Some claim, yes, just like Shabbos, we have it, so we have it on Yontif as well. Others say, no, it's only on Shabbos, not on Yontif. So the question is, according to the opinion that says that you have a neshama yisera, I think it's the opinion of the Rashbam, that you have a neshama yisera on Yontif, so then what's the question? Why don't we make a besamim when Yontif is over? If we have a neshama yisera on Yontif, if the reason why we make a besamim on Motzai Shabbos is because we're losing the neshama yisera, and on Yontif we have it and we lose it, so the question is, why don't we make in a Havdalah Bori Renei Besamim? Right? That's the question. So that's, so according to the Rashbam, what, where's the Borei Minei Besamim? But so according to Tosfos, according to those who say we don't have a Neshama Yisera, it fits in well. We don't have a Neshama Yisera, so therefore there's no need for Besamim. So what about, so according to, so therefore we don't need a Besam. What about Motzi Yontov Acharon? What about when, you know, what about, you know, when Yontov is over? So if you're assuming, let's say you go from Shabbos to Yontov. So when we go from Shabbos to Yontov, so we don't have Besamim. So the question is, Bishlom, if you say you have a Neshama Yisera, so then I understand. There's no need to make a Besamim because you kept a Neshama Yisera. But according to the Bali Tosfos, they say there's no Neshama Yisera on Yontif, so therefore we should make Besamim on Saturday night going into Yontif. So Tosfos says you're right. You know why we don't have Besamim? Because we have something even better. There's one thing walking by a nice bakery and smelling the cooks, the yummy cookies. There's another level actually eating them, the nice, fresh chocolate chip cooks. So we don't have to. We have a Sudas Yontov at night. So we have a Sudas Yontov that's better than Besamim. That cheers us up. So we're losing on the Shema Yisera according to Tosfos, but we don't need Besamim because we have a meal. So according to the Rashbam, we don't have Besamim because we didn't lose anything. We still have on the Shema Yisera on Yontif. According to Tosfos, we lost on the Shema Yisera. Where's the Besamim? We have something better. We have a meal. So the question Tosfos asks on the Rashbam then, that's good when it's Yontif Shachor B'Shabbat. What about Motzi Yontif Acharon? What about when Yontif ends? And there is, it's not Shabbat, you know, it was a regular Yontif and it's over. So we're losing on the Shema Yisera, so why don't we make a Besamim? That's why Tosfos rejects the Rashbam. At the end of Yontif, then I understand Shabbos, okay, you have an answer, either you're saying you're keeping the Shema Yisera, so therefore you don't need Besamim, or according to Tosfos, having a meal. But Tosfos' kasha on the Rashbam is, if you're telling me there's a Neshama Yisera, so when Yontif is over at the end, you should have to make a Besamim because you're losing your Neshama Yisera. So how do we answer up the clash on the Rashbam? So that's what the Shem Yishmul, the Avnei Nezer, points out, is because there's a fundamental difference between Kedusha Shabbos and Kedusha Yontif, as we mentioned. Kedusha Shabbos, Kiva V'Kaimei, it's basically comes by itself, it doesn't need us. Every Shabbos, it's inherently Kadosh. You know, we make Kiddush, we do other things to give it a token Kedusha, but ultimately it doesn't need us. Yontif, it's Makadosh Yisrael V'Hazman, we bring on the sanctity. So when we bring on, we all know in life, easy come, easy go. We live in the world of Olam Hazeh, whether it's physical or spiritual, whether it's business, recreation, pleasure, the more you put into something, the more you get out of it. And that's what Yontif is all about. It's Makadosh Yisrael. We brought the Kedusha, and therefore it's more meaningful and it stays. And that's why, when it comes to Shabbos, that's why it says the Meshech Chochma writes by Har Sinai. When the Jews left Har Sinai, the Kedusha left right away. Because easy come, easy go. They didn't do anything. They stood there. God did everything. And so when they left, you don't make an initiative. You're not proactive. That's it. But Yontif, we did. And that's why, so Yontif, it's true that when Yontif is over now, we're losing on the Shema Yisera. But it's different. On Shabbos, easy come, easy go. Then the Shema disappears quickly because we didn't put any effort. But on Yantav, we worked for it. We brought the Kedusha. So the Nisham Yisera slowly fades away as opposed to disappearing. So if it's disappearing quickly, we need the Besamim. But it's, when it goes back slowly, so therefore we don't need the Besamim. That's the Pshat. But that's what we see, these different levels of Kedusha. That Kedusha's Eretz Yisrael has both elements. Has the Kedusha, the inherent Kedusha, as well as the Kedusha of Makadosh Yisrael of the Azmanim. And that's what the Parsha is teaching us, the different levels of Kedusha, Kedushas HaMikdash, Kedushas Man, and Kedushas Adam. And in fact, that's what they point out. It says in the beginning of the Parsha, Amo Kohanim B'nei Aaron V'amarta Aleim L'nefesh Lo Yita Mi'amav. In other words, since the Kedusha of the Kohen is different, in other words, it's a double language in the Pasuk. Emor Kohanim and Aaron V'amarta. Why the double language? Emor V'amarta. So Rashi tells us, the Chazal tells us, V'hazir Gedolim Alakatanim. That it's warning the parents, they have to make sure to take care that even your child under 13, he has to stay, you have to try to keep him away from cemeteries, from being metame. And we see a tremendous lesson in chinuch, in bringing up children, and not limited to Kohen, that why the double language by Tumas Kohanim? Why not by blood? Why not by shruts and by bugs? Well, the answer is, the assumption is, no one eats treif. So therefore, when you bring up your kids, hopefully everyone around you also is eating kosher. So it's not easy by any means, but it's a lot easier when the societal flow is with you. When society's values are different than yours, it's much more difficult to bring up kids. But Emor V'amarta by Lahazer Gedol V'Katanim, because your son can't go into the cemetery or pass by a place where there's a dead. But everyone else can, so you have to have special cleanup for your kids to explain to them the importance of your Kedushas Kahuna. And similarly, you have to explain to your kids the Kedushas Yisrael. While everyone else is doing it, you have to explain why they can't necessarily do it as well. And just to conclude, there's a beautiful pshat from Rav Yitzchak Elchanan, one of the great gedolim in Europe. On this pasuk, he says homiletically, "Vayomer Hashem al Moshe." God tells Moses, "Emor al Kohanim b'nei Aaron." Tell the Kohanim b'nei Aaron, which, by the way, the laws of defilement of a cemetery, it only applies to male Kohanim. Not to the daughter of a Kohen, nor to a wife of a Kohen. So speak to the Kohanim, the B'nai Aaron. What did B'nai Aaron? What was Aaron's characteristic? Olev Shalom, Verodev Shalom. He was a man who ran after peace and always looked for peace. That was Aaron. He always taught two people fighting. He worked it out among them. And the Amar Talayim, and to the Kohanim, who are the leaders of the Jewish people, make sure they make shalom, that there's peace, there's achdus among the Jewish people. V'amarta l'aleim, and tell them again, l'nefesh lo yita mi'amav, don't defile yourself. In other words, everyone knows unity and peace is a beautiful thing, the ultimate. And in fact, that was machlokas, the president and Jack, in 24 this week. What takes precedence, peace or justice? But that's not for now. We'll have to discuss that later. But we know peace is a tremendous milah, unity, achdus, and God only dwells among the Jewish people when there's no fighting, when there's achdus, shalom bayis, the mezuzah, that the mezuzah is on a slant, because to realize you have to compromise when you walk into your home, etc. So we all know the greatness of shalom bayis and peace. But at what price do you pay for peace? Do you knock down every principle you have in order to get it? So that's what Rabbi Yitzchak says, "Nefesh lo yitama b'yamav." If you have to defile yourself to make peace, then you know you've gone too far. L'nefesh l'yita b'yamav. In fact, that's the Gemara in Bechoros, that the Gemara talks about a case where sometimes you do things that are more destructive than constructive. So the Gemara example is you have a reed 8 feet wide, and the house, the door is only 6 foot wide. The guy's struggling, pushing in and pushing in, and he knocks down the whole house trying to get the 8 foot reed. The point is, you cause more harm than good. If you're going to knock down the whole edifice, the whole principles that the house is built on, that the Judaism is built on, the one of you accomplished. So of course, unity is a great thing in peace, and that's what he's saying. Amoro Kohanim and Aaron, speak to the Kohanim, our leaders, to make peace and unity. However, everything has the limits. Don't defile yourself when you make peace and try to compromise as much as you can. However, if you have to defile yourself and break every principle in the Torah and break down the edifices, the whole foundation of the Torah, then l'nefesh lo yitav, you've gone too far, and then you have to stand true to the principle, and you, in certain individual cases, then you will not be able to compromise and make peace.